Welcome. We'll start with Class 12th NCERT, the practical sections in geography. The first chapter talks about data, the sources and the compilation. So in this topic, we would be understanding what is data, how data can be transformed into meaningful thing which we call as information, and then processing the data, grouping the data, applying the various statistics and classification of that data is really, really important, and that's what we would be understanding through this lecture. Now, data, the singular term that is used is what is datum. That's important. If you look around the world, you would find data in nearly everything that exists. So let's say, how many patients suffered from malaria? There was an outbreak of a malaria or an epidemic into a city. So you have numbers there. If you talk about temperature, if you talk about rainfall, when you talk about weather forecast, if you talk about any accident or a casualty on a roadside, everything has numbers. And whenever you have numbers that come into play, you have representation of those numbers in a systematic form. That's important. When you have numbers which are given or numbers that are explained, we call it as data. And this data, when represented into a meaningful way so that you can get answer to a given query, makes it an information. So information is helping you to answer or address any of the queries. So let's say my query is, what is the temperature range for the state of Rajasthan in India? Then over the years, you would look onto the monthly temperature and then you can say, okay, this is the range of temperature for the state of Rajasthan. So with this information that I have, I can answer the query about the monthly range of the temperature variations for any state or whatsoever the question is. So turning data into a meaningful thing is important, and that's what is information. Now another question comes in, why do we actually need a data? There is no requirement to understand or have a data, but the understanding comes from here. Let's say there are 100 people living in a city. After 10 years, you have 10,000 people in that city. So to accommodate that huge exponential growth of the population, you would need housing conditions, you would need the sanitation system, you would need to have certain job structure. So there is a need for data, because with this rising population, you have to create more jobs, you have to create employment opportunities, you have to create housing infrastructure. So there is a need to understand this data that is there. Again, with the help of this data that's there, you can graphically represent something, you can spatially represent something. So geographical analysis can become much more easier. Representation of things on maps becomes further easy. So all these are, I can say, the prerequisite of having the data and understanding that this data is really important and significant. The next case that we would be discussing is pretty interesting. Now let's say I have a very simple example for you. There is a boy. This boy is 3 feet in height. Okay. There is a river that this boy is trying to cross. Listen to the question carefully. I say the average depth of this river is 2.5 feet. Then will the boy be able to cross? He does not know swimming. So will he be able to cross the river or not? Definitely you all will say, yes, of course, the average depth is just 2.5 feet and he is 3 feet tall. So he would definitely be able to cross the river. But the most important thing that you lacked here was the detailed understanding of the data. Now, when I say average depth is 2.5 feet, that means that's just the average. If I say the depth across four different points, let's say at one point it's 2, at another point it's 3, at another point it's 4, and at yet another point it's, let's say, 1. So the average could turn out to be something else. So it would be 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 divided by 4. So that would be 10 by 4. Okay, so you would have 10 by 4, that's 2.5. Okay, so perfect. So you have the answer there. Okay, now this is the scenario. I have calculated the average depth. Average depth is the sum of all depths divided by the number of depths that I have taken into account. So it's 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. That's 10 divided by 4. Okay, and that I have taken into account to find out the average depth, which comes out to be 2.5. But in this case, I can easily say the boy would drown, because if the boy does not know swimming, he can sail from 1 foot, sail from 2 foot, but at 3 foot, it would be at the height of the child, and as soon as he enters the region of 4 foot, he will get drowned. So the idea here is to understand that it's not only important to just collect the data or just present the data. Understanding the facts and the figures becomes very, very important. So just by saying that I know the average depth, I cannot lead out or turn out onto any results. I need to have the integrate understanding of each of the components, and then only I can give a result. So whenever you are doing data analysis or using any analytical tool or technique, it's very important to make your study highly logical, highly precise, and rather conclusive in nature. So just by giving an average depth and the height of the child, I cannot lead to a conclusion that the child will not drown in this case. I hope that's clear. And therefore, presentation of the data is very, very important. The next important thing is the types of data. So types of data, you have the primary and the secondary data. Primary data is one which you yourself collect. Secondary data is a data in which you rely on other sources. So when I say I myself collect, how can it be possible? I can go to a field, do a field survey, see the number of literates, illiterates, the quality of water supply, sanitation, household conditions, elderly people, young people, all those information by my visual understanding, by my observation, what is collected is a personal observation through field surveys. The next is interview. Now, interview is indeed important. Interview, when we say, it should be in a very simple language so that someone else can comprehend it. The question should be very, very clear. I should make sure that my question does not hurt the self-respect of someone else. There is a congenial environment that is maintained in order to have that questionnaire or have that question being put up. Again, you need to understand what all information you are asking for. You are not asking any additional information which is beyond the scope of your research. And then finally, you have to be grateful or thankful to one who gave the interview. Okay, the next is questionnaire and schedule. The most important section of this class, most of the students are confused here. The difference between a questionnaire and a schedule. So questionnaire is something that is being filled by the candidate itself. However, schedule is something that is being filled by one who is conducting the survey or the enumerator. Now, what is the difference, the key aspect that differs in the two? When I say schedule, I am focusing on the thing that since I am an enumerator, I am doing the study, I can count on literate as well as illiterate. However, if I am the person who is filling the questionnaire, I must be literate in order to fill that questionnaire. So here is a key difference between a questionnaire and a schedule. Schedule being completed by enumerator, so is applicable to both literate and illiterate population. However, questionnaire works only with the literate population, and then there could be other kind of test, for example, water quality, soil quality assessment. So those are other primary tests that you could do. When it comes to secondary, there could be published data vis-a-vis the unpublished data. Published data from the government record, so definitely I can say Census of India publishes through the Office of the Registrar. You have weather forecasting department, weather reports being published by IMD, Indian Meteorological Department, and so on and so forth. quasi-government, which is also known as semi-government data. Now, this semi-government data is usually from the urban development authorities, Zila Parishad, or the various corporations of the city and the town. International data from UNESCO, UNDP, World Health Organization, Food and Agricultural Organization, and all international UN and all international organizations. Private data could be in the form of yearbooks, monographs, okay, pertaining to personal informations. Newspaper and electronic media. So newspaper is a kind of print media, electronic media is a kind of media available through internet and on computers. So that's how you have the published category. Unpublished sources are those which are not documented. So unpublished, you would have government, I would say land records maintained by Patwari are not published anywhere. Similarly, in the quasi-government, you could say the periodicals that come through the various municipal corporations are not published anywhere. Similarly, you have private associations like Resident Welfare Association. So they don't have their brochures being published or all details being published. So it's a kind of unpublished data that's there. So definitely, secondary sources, we rely more on the published data as compared to the unpublished data. The next important thing is tabulation and classification. Now, as we have understood, we could classify data into two types, that's the primary data and the secondary data. If I am not doing anything with the data, let's say I am taking 60 students of my class and marking down the weight of all the students. So it's 20, 21, 23, 24, 48, 29 and random numbers. Okay. Does this data make any sense? Is it useful? It is not at all usable. It does not make any sense. Okay. So the simplest way to understand or represent this data is through tabulation. I can create a table. Now, table could be in various forms. I could mention the age group. Based on the age group, I can mention the weight. So, let's say age group 0 to 10 years have weight of 8, average weight of 8. Then 10 to 20, the average weight is 12. 20 to 30, the average weight is 15, and so on and so forth. So, what I'm trying to do here is I am trying to classify the data. Now, this could be on the basis of age group. This could be on the basis of class. Within the class, if I am trying to give the weight, it could be on the basis of sections. So, class A, class 1, section A, class 1, section B, class 1, section C, and so on. And then the respective weights. Or n number of ways, I could have a classification. And against the weight, I could also have the number of students that I am taking into account. So let's say here my number of students were 20, here 25, here 30. So against what number of students, what is my average weight? That's what I have taken into account. So that's one way of representing the data. The other way of representing the data would be simply I can say students in this age group have 4 classes a day. So let's say classes 1. So class 1 students have 4 periods a day. Class 2 students have again 4. Class 3 students have 5. Class 4 students have 5. Then you have class 5 students have 6 periods a day. So number of classes you have per day would be explained here. So that's another way of classification. The next way of classification could be I could have the data that could be explained in 3 forms. It could be the absolute data. It could be percentage or ratio data. And lastly, it could be a index data. Now, how do I understand this? I can say you have a state, you have population, you have growth rate. Okay. So I create another column for population for 1981, population for 1991. So what I am doing, state A, population of let's say 10,000. In 1991, the population jumped to 12,000. Okay. So what I am doing here, population of 1981 is an absolute population. I am just counting on to the numbers that is there. So original representation of data in the form of integers is what is known as absolute numbers. So that's first way. The second is percentage, where I calculate. So percentage change in the population, I could say. So that's 12,000 minus 10,000 divided by 10,000 into 100. So that's how I change or I find the growth rate. Similarly, if it is literacy across 2 years, I can find a literacy rate. So that's how you represent the percentage or ratio. So ratio is just simply new population by old population. So 12,000 by 10,000 would be a kind of ratio. But when I say growth rate, I find out a change. And that's how we understand the change. The last is index numbers. Now, index numbers is really interesting. So what you do is current year divided by the base year into 100. So into 100. So let's say it's 12,000 by 10,000 into 100. And that's how an index number is explained. So index number is a statistical measure to show the changes in the variables or the groups of related variables, I could say, with respect to some of the things. The first thing could be time. The second thing could be a geographical location or any other form of industrial data, climatic data. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to find relation between two aspects. That could be based on time, it could be based on year, it could be based on location, it could be based on industry, climate, or any other aspect. So what is important is to understand percentage, ratio, index numbers, and the difference between these. So classification and tabulation works under three forms. Either I can use absolute data, I can use the percentage or the ratio, or I could work as index numbers. Clear? The next is processing. So under processing, what you can do is, first of all, you tabulate the data as we did. So you have the state, you have the populations, and then you have the growth rate that is there, and that's how you have tabulated it. Then I can group the data. So grouping or ungrouping the data is another important aspect. So what I can do is West, I can divide India into West, East, North and South. So I am grouping the data. So I'll merge up all the states which are on the West. I'll merge up all the states which are on the East, similarly North and South. And I'll club the data. Based on that clubbing, I'll have or grouping, I would have a different analysis that I could say the population in the West is less as compared to the East, or so on and so forth. So I could have my results based on grouping of the data, ungrouped data. So processing of the data is important. So that's one way in which you can group. The other way in which you can group is across literacy, across educational standards, across the child ratio or the sex ratio, I could say. So there are various ways under which you could group the data or club the data. The next is grouping the data. I simply say I have age group. Okay. I have number of children in each age group. And that's the frequency of the children. So let's say I make it interesting here. Okay. So this is a good example that we would be covering here. So I have age group 0 to 10, I have 4 children. 10 to 20, I have 5 children. 20 to 30, I have 6 children. 30 to 40 age group, I have not children now, adults. Okay, so 6 more. Okay, so how much is the total here? So it's 9 plus 12, that's 9 and 12, you have 21. Now what I do is, I find the cumulative frequency, which is also known as CF or cumulative frequency. So in the first case, it's 4. In the second case, I add 5 to it, so it becomes 9. Now I add 6 more, so it becomes 15. And final value is 21. So all the people, children, whoever is present, up to the age of 40, are how many? They are 21 in number. So this shows me a very, very clear picture explaining that the total number of children that we have taken into account are 21. Now, of this, if I say all the children below the age of 20 years, how many are they? They are 9 in number. So when representing on a graph, I can say in the first group, they are 4. In the second group, they are 5. In the third group, they are 6 and they are again 6. So what is this? This is a frequency polygon that is being explained. So frequency polygon is the distribution, the frequency distribution explained in a graphical form that helps you to compare the various age groups. So you have the age group that is there, and then you have the number of children that is here. Now, these midpoints could be joined. So I can join these midpoints, okay? The next important thing is, whenever Ogive is one concept where you are trying to compare the frequencies, and when comparing these frequencies, you are adding those up through the cumulative frequency. So whenever I am using cumulative frequency to depict something, I call it as Ogive. So you have, it's Ogive, but it's pronounced as Ogive. So that's again important. It's G, but we pronounce it as J. Okay. Now you have 4, 9, 15, and 21. So that's how I mark my graph. So that's less than. Now, all the people or the children less than 10 years, how many are they? Very, very simple. So less than 10 years, I have 4 children. Less than 20 years, how many children? I have 9 children. Less than 15 years, how many children? There are 15 children. And less than 30 years, and less than 40 years, I have 21 children. So this is a curve that shows less than. But let me do a little modification. If I say more than, so I say more than 0, how many children? All of the children that are there are more than 0. So I have 21 there. Now more than 10, how many are there? I'll just remove the 4 from the top. So I have 17 people who are more than 10. Okay. Then I have more than 20 years. How many of those are there? More than 10, I would just subtract 5 more. So that's 12. And more than 30, I have 6 people that are there. So when I draw an Ogive curve of less than, it goes like this. Okay, when I draw a Ogive curve of more than, it goes like this. So more than, less than curves are used to explain the Ogives. Ogives are usually explained with cumulative frequency. So you are adding up all the cumulative frequencies, listing those either in the less than format or the more than format. And once you have done that, you have the table that's created. One more important aspect, and the last aspect that we would talk about, is inclusive series versus an exclusive series. So what is this? Exclusive series, I say 0 to 10 years, 10 to 20 years, 20 to 30 years. I am saying there are 4 children, 5 children, and 6 children. But here, this 10 is not included in this series. It's included in this series because 10 is coming 2 times. So I'll have to exclude it in one series and include it in another series. So here I would include all the children from 0 to 9, but this 10 would be included in the next series till 19. Okay. So this is an exclusive series where the numbers are replicated in the next columns. However, when I say inclusive series, I say 0 to 9, 4 children, 10 to 19, 5 children, and 20 to 29, I have 6 children. That means I am including 0 and 9. One of the child could be 0 years or newborn. The other child could be 9 years. So I am including the both the extremities within my tabulation, and that's what is an inclusive series. However, under exclusive series, I can say one of the child could be newborn, but the other child is not 10 years. He could be 8 years, 9 years, 7 years or whatsoever, but not 10 years, because 10 years is going into the next series from 10 to 20. So that's an exclusive series. So simply put up, we have within the frequencies, we have the inclusive series, the exclusive series. Each of the frequency that we talk about is explained into simple groups and concepts. So that's very, very important to understand. So with this, we wind up this class. If you have any doubts, any questions, feel free to drop this in an email, and we would be more than happy to resolve those, or just put those as a comment. Have a wonderful day ahead.